So let's talk a little bit about myeloma for patients who are just getting started. So you may not be familiar with myeloma, and so this is good for you. But let me tell you, I was just having a nice chat with a patient yesterday who said, you know, Dr. Joe, I went to an IMF workshop last week, and I've had myeloma for 10 years, and I'm pretty much well informed. Listening to the simple introduction to myeloma was again helpful to me. And so if you're here today and you're expert in myeloma, it's still very possible that you're going to learn something, and it helps consolidate what you might know about myeloma. So sometimes I describe myeloma of course, it's a disease of the blood. So we have to think a bit about the basics of the blood. And the blood is made of the liquidy stuff that circulates, and there's some solid stuff in it. And the solid stuff are what we call cells. And we have three kinds of cells in our blood, red, white, and platelets. So red cells are like just little trucks that carry oxygen that circulate in your body. I think of them as trucks that pick up oxygen from the lungs, deliver them to the tissues. White cells are a little bit different. They're kind of your army. They're the immune system. They're protecting you and fighting for you. And then thirdly, you have these tiny little cells called platelets that are cells that if you cut yourself, they're the first ones to get there to plug up the hole so you stop bleeding. They're kind of like the ambulance to get there first. And all three of these cells are made inside your blood factory, which is called the bone marrow. And this is where it becomes important to us. On the other hand, what is cancer? So I'm going to explain what the blood is, what cancer is, and then join the two together. So what is cancer? Cancer is just identical, uncontrolled growth. It's easier to think about a piece of lung tissue or breast tissue or colon tissue, but this is what happens. It's just growth that we can't easily stop. And so the body wants to grow. We all grow. Sometimes we grow in places that we don't want to grow, but we grow, and it's meant to be in control. But when that control is lost is when we have cancer. What's really unfortunate about blood cancers is that what is growing out of control is not skin or bone or breast or lung or colon, but the very cells that are protecting you. And so these are the ones that are meant to help and protect you. And now they have gone cancerous. And so that's what sometimes we think of as a double whammy. So you don't have the protection you normally have, but the very ones that are meant to protect you are now hurting you. And so that gets you into trouble. So myeloma is a blood cancer of what we call the plasma cell that lives in your bone marrow. Plasma cells are little cells that make antibodies. We've been hearing a lot about antibodies during COVID, right? You go get your COVID vaccine. We hope all of you have done that, and your booster even. And what does it do? It sends a message to your body's plasma cells to make antibodies that can fight off COVID if you do get COVID. And that's what plasma cells are meant to do. So in fact, plasma cells have been really highlighted this last year in COVID. The problem in myeloma is these same plasma cells now become bad, become cancerous. And instead of making antibodies that fight infections, now they make antibodies that literally fight against you. And you'll hear this throughout. We call these the bad antibodies or the immunoglobulins. You know, we love to use words that patients don't understand, right, in medicine. That just means immune proteins or immune proteins that can help fight against bad things, but now unfortunately are fighting against yourself. And so that M or monoclonal protein, mono just means it's the same type and shape. Normally, if you have regular antibodies in your system, you got antibodies to tons of things, measles, mumps, rubella, whatever else. But here now you're developing bad antibodies or M spikes or M proteins. The myeloma is not a very common disease. It accounts for about 2% of all cancers. We expect about 35,000 new cases this year in the US, and sadly, about 12,500 deaths. I mentioned that it's twice as common in the African American population. And I mentioned that unfortunately, although we've seen this amazing improvement in survival over this last several years, there's still a group of patients that are particularly high risk, what we call high risk myeloma, where their survival has not been as great. But now, overall, we're expecting most patients can live a decade with this disease. Although, as I mentioned, we've not seen the same advancement in the African-American population. Again, to just recap then, these are the funny looking plasma cells that live in your bone marrow, and now they make these bad proteins or these immunoglobulins. We have different classes of immunoglobulins, and that's why we give them these different names or letters of G, A, M, D, and E. And so people can have a myeloma of immunoglobulin G type or A type or M type as we go through. So when we think about the diagnosis, people don't walk in and say, oh, doctor, I think the plasma cells in my bone marrow are growing. That's obviously, none of us can feel or sense that. So the diagnosis can be challenging. So about a third of patients present with fatigue, and not just the regular fatigue, I don't feel like getting out of bed this morning, but really profound fatigue. Over half of patients present with bone pain, and about three quarters of patients have anemia or a low red blood cell count, those trucks that I talked about that carry the oxygen for us. And this is one of the most important slides I'm going to show to you today, because nobody has a sign over their head that says, I have myeloma. It's a very challenging diagnosis to make because there's no specific sign or symptom around it. But these are the three that are the most common. And without getting into too much detail, we have come to learn that myeloma, which is in the red bar here, is where we see a lot of those plasma cells in the bone marrow, and we see that it's damaging the body, like the bones, as I showed you, or the low red blood cell count, and I'll show you some other things. But we've learned that myeloma is always preceded by something else, or something that comes before. And that's typically what we call MGUS, or monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance. I know that's a mouthful. You can see why we call it MGUS, because this disease can grow for many years in people's systems before it becomes very active. We're going to come back to that concept a little bit later. But when it damages the body, it typically damages it in four areas, at least one of the four areas, what we call CRAB. The calcium can be high, the renal or the kidney can be damaged, there can be anemia, or there is bone disease, and that's how we make the diagnosis. And so when people are anemic, they're tired. When they have low blood counts, they can get infections. When the kidney is damaged, believe it or not, we can get even fatigue from that. And then, of course, when the bone is damaged, we can see a lot of bone pain, not just a little ache here and there, but tends to be deep, severe bone pain. And so this is how a lot of patients end up arriving at the diagnosis. And then now in the last 10 minutes or so that I have before we move on to our interview with Dr. Blue, I want us to think about how we treat this disease. So hopefully the diagnosis can be made more accurately, and we're going to share with you later how we're trying to change, train even the medical world to make the diagnosis. But when we come to choose treatment, it's not simple. There isn't a simple myeloma cookbook that says, you know, thou shalt do this or thou shalt do that to treat this disease. This is a disease that requires a whole lot of discussion, and it'll depend on what your preference is, which I put right in the middle here, because that becomes important. We don't, as I said earlier about Charisse's presentation later, we don't treat myeloma, we treat people. And so you have to be at the center of that. And one of the things we advocate for is you have the right for a second opinion. A lot of doctors that take care of myeloma, they're great doctors, but they also take care of 50 other different kinds of cancers. And they may not have the expert opinion in a rare disease like myeloma. And so you can seek out expertise in the area who can tell you a bit more about the disease and what may be new, what may be offered uniquely to myeloma patients, including clinical trials, as we'll talk about later. Now, I know there's a lot of information on the slide, and I'm not planning to walk through it. I just wanted to give you, almost overwhelm you with good, with something good, that is to say, we have a lot of choice of drugs to use in multiple myeloma. When I started in myeloma almost 25 years ago, we only had one or two things on this whole list, but now we have a huge list with different classes of drugs. And today's talk is not designed to walk through them. Sometimes we do a workshop where we do really detailed evaluation of each of these things. But I just wanted to give you a sense that there is treatment for myeloma. Sometimes people hear, oh, but myeloma can't be cured, and therefore it's terminal, and therefore what's the point? No, no, no. There is a point to treatment. As I mentioned before, the average patient with myeloma now lives over 10 years. And thankfully, a lot of these drugs that are being developed, which is very encouraging to me, are being developed in a way not just to hit the cancer, but to give a patient a better quality of life. More and more drugs are being given by mouth, like as a pill, or given in a short subcutaneous injection in the skin instead of long infusions. More and more drugs are being developed that allow you to retain as much of the quality of life and lifestyle that you want. And so we think of them as these big pillars of treatment. And so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but again, I wanted to show this slide to you almost to overwhelm you that we have so many choices that we never used to have before. So when we do come to treat people, what do we do? What is the choice? What guides the choice between all of those drugs that I just listed in what we have here? Well, first of all, we have these, what I call principles of treating patients. And I have six principles listed here. Number one, what we do in our first treatment is really important. Sometimes we think, oh, well, I got to have lots of different treatments over the time. So it kind of doesn't really matter what order I choose. What we do up front makes a lot of difference in the long run. This is our chance to really control the disease for a long time. The longest time that the disease is controlled, or what we call in remission, is often that first time. Number two, we don't save the best for last, as I've said before. Sometimes I've joked and said, you know, save the best for last is great for a romantic movie, but not for myeloma, because we want to use our better combinations. Remember how we commented earlier that unfortunately African-Americans are less likely to get triplets? Those are the very triplets, and we might even be moving towards quadruplets, four drugs, by the way, up front. Those triplets are what make a difference in the long term. And so we don't want to save them for later. We want to use combinations together. There's no one magic drug or pill for myeloma. It's mixing these drugs together that has really made a big difference. And what we want is what I call the two Ds, a deep and durable remission. So whatever measure of that bad protein in your blood, the M protein, we want to see it go down, and we want to see it stay down as we treat people. And we typically do that mix and match from three classes of drugs up front, what are called proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory drugs, and monoclonal antibodies. And then early on, we decide, should someone have what we call a stem cell transplant or not? And that's typically where we divide people, is that transplant is giving a pretty intense amount of treatment. And so we want to make sure that people are so-called eligible for it, that they're ready for it, that they're strong enough for it. And based on that decision, we go down two kind of different treatment algorithms, where we typically give a triplet combination. And then if someone has a transplant, they get the transplant, and then they get on a little bit of less therapy. And if someone is not getting a transplant, they just remain on that therapy. So I'm going to close with three questions to ask in a transplant eligible and transplant ineligible patients. That is really an update in what we've been learning recently. So the first question is, transplant necessary? Is transplant still necessary? Well, yes, we have lots of studies just recently showing us that it still actually helps. And so we still pursue stem cell transplants in patients. Number two, what is the best triplet combination? Is it what we call VRD with Velcade, Revlimid, and Dexamethasone, or KRD, Carfilzomib, Revlimid, and Dexamethasone? And the good answer is both. In some patients, we choose one. In some patients, we choose another. And then the third question, which is really a hot topic and will be discussed at our a big meeting in a few weeks from now, is, are we going to actually now go not just from using triplets, but using quadruplets? And I think the answer is yes, we're not quite fully there, but we're getting very close to it. As we add to those combinations I mentioned, either a drug called daratumumab or isatuximab, as we give these drugs early on. So when we think about frontline therapy, we're going to be probably moving to quadruplets. We're still doing transplants, and we're likely going to be doing more after the transplant. My last set of three questions are for the patients who aren't going to transplant. So one question is, are triplets better than doublets? And we've actually now shown that this is the case. There was a day where we thought, we don't know if we can ever give three drugs together to patients who aren't going to transplant, because typically these are older patients, maybe a bit more frail, maybe have other conditions like heart disease and diabetes and other things that may make the transplant more difficult. but we really have seen that we can do better with triplets. Not only triplets, but question two, how long should we treat patients? But that if patients are tolerating their drugs well, that we continue it long-term. It's like controlling a long-term disease, that the longer that someone has it under control, the better they're going to do. And then are there ways that we can make these combinations more tolerable? And that is a huge area of work and research, because people hear the word chemotherapy and they think bald and barf, right? I mean, that's what we classically think of this. And so we're trying to develop more and more strategies that are easier on patients. So my conclusion for transplant ineligible patients is that although we still transplant a lot of patients, we have to be careful in who we select for it. This continuous therapy or ongoing therapy has really done better for patients. And we're typically choosing from those same three classes of drugs that I've mentioned, either what we call the DRD combination or the VRD combination. And I've tended to use a little bit more DRD in most standard risk patients. And that we're looking in the future to maybe even doing quadruplets in this patient population as well. Again, my last slide to sort of overwhelm you is that we have so many drugs being developed in myeloma. I've just talked a little bit about that frontline therapy. Dr. Nuka in a moment is going to make sense of this alphabet soup that you see in rescue therapy. There's no way you can learn all these words instantly, but it is so exciting for me. Again, going back to when I started with myeloma, where there was maybe three total words on this list. And now, as you can see, it's over 20, if not even 30, of all the options and the combinations that we have. So we want to be optimistic today, realistic, but optimistic as we think a bit about multiple myeloma and what we do when we first have a patient with multiple myeloma. So you've heard way too much from me already, but hopefully if you've been napping for the last 35 minutes, in brief, we've come to appreciate how important myeloma is within the African-American community and how important the first treatment is for patients with multiple myeloma.